grateful to God first, but to these musicians who, when we're down two, can make us sound that great. We miss Michael, we miss Daniel this morning, but you guys, fantastic. Hit it right out of the park. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Yeah, some of you are sick. I can tell this because as soon as we stopped singing, I heard from like all across the room. So I'm sorry about that. And I hope being in church this morning will help bring energy, not just to the spirit, but to the body as well. Today is the first Sunday after the Epiphany. It's also known as Baptism of the Lord Sunday. We're going to begin our service praying together as we always do, joys and concerns. And let me just check. See the kiddo. Okay, good. I've heard from you during the week, and actually over the last couple weeks. We haven't had a normal church service in quite a few weeks, so these prayer requests are for the last couple weeks. I shouldn't go any further without saying that today is just such a special day in the life of the church because we're receiving new members today, Elaine and Cindy Tanner. We look forward to that after the sermon time. Well, with that, let's begin an attitude of prayer. Hear us as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. After everything, you just wait and then everyone explodes. It's time for the children to come forward. Ooh, apparently there was a race. Yes, for the snow, God. We love the snow. We ask that we have fun times playing in it.
And thank you especially for Jesus and for Sunday School. I pray in his name. Amen. Lord God, we're glad to be here. We're glad for this place and these people, and most of all, your love for us and your presence with us through the Holy Spirit. We ask, God, that during this time that you would allow our hearts and minds to be open and alert to what you are saying to us today, and that the words wouldn't just end here, God, but that we would walk out the door with them and that they can have impact into our lives. I ask that you would help me to think clearly and speak clearly. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I tell you, it feels really nice to be back here doing regular church. We had a few weeks doing irregular church. Last weekend, we worshiped on Saturday at the Congregational Church, which was highly irregular, by the way, the Saturday part. It was a beautiful New Year's Eve worship service at 11 in the morning. And I was proud of you all because our church made up half of the people at that worship service, and their church is three times the size of ours. So way to turn up. Great.
Amen.
One of the things you might remember from that worship service, if you were there, and I will bless you with this knowledge if you were not there, is that at the end, there was no musician for the service, and there were some activities that we did, and a reflection that Pastor Rick led us through. But at the very end, we were in the sanctuary, and we had a sheet of music in front of us. It was Let There Be Peace on Earth. We love this song. We know this song. Many of us have heard this song over and over again. And so Pastor Vic puts me on the spot. He stands right here. He says, what note should we start on? There's no musician. And so I said, let there, we start there. We just all sang. So I'm an alto. Turns out that was a little low, by the way. We ended up way down in the gravel pit. I didn't know. I was just reaching for a note. If he had let me prepare, I could have gone and plunked on the piano or something, but I didn't. I didn't have that one. I experienced similar things while Christmas caroling with the Hood School Elementary kids over at the Hillview. What is it called now? Across from the Hillview?
Meadowview,
the most current iteration.
That's not the right. That's what everybody calls it.
Changes the name like every few years.
Sunbridge?
I don't know. The nursing home across from the Hillview Country Club is where the kids were Christmas caroling. And again, no pitch pipe, no piano. And so they'll pitch, you know, a song way up here, and now you're singing in the stratosphere. It's kind of crazy. And I'm glad that probably a lot of the residents are hard of hearing anyway. So it didn't hopefully affect what we were doing too much. But you've had this happen, right, when we start a song. Okay, we're gonna try. Okay. Because this metaphor is very central to my sermon today. If I were to ask you, don't do it, no sounds. But if I were to ask you to start singing the national anthem, O Say Be You See, imagine in your mind, how does that sound? Okay, no shh. No sounds. Imagine, okay. Right, you kind of know, and if I just said, let's just launch into it, it would sound like a train wreck, because we'd be on all different notes. But you kind of know where you might start, right? You would pitch it, maybe based on your vast experience of what a difficult song that is to sing, you would know that you need to start in a certain place. So let's just see what two different people in this room have come up with for a nice starting pitch for the national anthem. I prepped Carolyn and Nicole, knowing one, that they're excellent singers, two, that they love to perform, three, that they have different vocal ranges. And so, Carolyn, where are you?
Over here.
Thank you. Yes, you are. In a range that is good for you, Carolyn, to sing the national anthem, where would you start it?
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light.
Good. Okay, there we go. Okay, that's where we're going to end up, right? Okay, we know that. So, Nicole, what do you think? Where would you start? So then you're going, in the room again, right? Okay, so two different pitches, right? And both of them, let's just say, for the argument's sake, that those are excellent keys for you to have chosen, because you know the lows and the highs of that song. They work very well for you personally. But if we want to sing as a group and we want to do it well, like we do at the Red Sox or other sporting events, we're not going to be able to go with an internal sense of pitch, what I think is best today. Even if we're an expert like Carolyn and Nicole and kind of know, we're not going to be able to do that. We're going to have to say, okay, everybody, let's do it. We're feeling very, very patriotic today in the new year. How about this key here? Oh, say can you see? Okay, you got the bottom note, and then you probably have it, right? That's the key we should. That's usual, right? I had to Google the heck out of that, by the way, to find that.
Oh,
that's
yeah,
the key. And
starts on A flat.
I forgot that, you know, I'm busy, Mom.
You should remember that because you make me so.
Well, where do you think I got it from, right? No, I'm just teasing it. Actually, no, Google is quite divided on the subject. But anyway.
Key of G.
So the external pitch is important, okay? You're with me. Internal pitch, external pitch. Let's turn this into a spiritual metaphor. So when we live our lives, we try to stay in tune with that, right? We try to pitch our lives according to God's perspective. But we are surrounded by a culture that says really great sounding things, truly great sounding things, like, you gotta sing your own song, and you gotta do what's good for you, right? You need to find what's best for you. Culture is saying, you set your own pitch. And it does sound really good because we want to be respectful of other people. When we say to people, you need to do what's best for you, or you need to set your own pitch for the national anthem, when we say things like that, what we're saying is, I respect you and the decisions you make, even when they're different than mine. So I get what we're saying when we say that, but I want us to be aware that we're just surrounded by people who are talking about relative pitch all over the place. But as people of faith, we understand that we have this external, living force, this creator who made the whole universe, who made us, who sent Jesus, this external source of the true pitch for our lives. And it's a little hard with our postmodern minds. We like to be very relative. But Christianity, by definition, says there is someone besides me who knows what's best for me. So there's a number of different places in the scriptures, many different places in the scriptures, that can show us examples of people who are really trying to be in tune with God rather than in tune with the world around them to get the starting note for the song that God's going to have them sing. And one of them comes from a story that I have never preached on in 15 years. Never preached on it. Go find it. It's in 2 Chronicles, chapter 20. What a neat story this is. See, Amanda already knows. She said, I know the story from 2 Chronicles. You know where I'm going with this, don't you? A story, of course, about King Jehoshaphat. I said to Sam, Jehoshaphat? And he said, what did you just call me? And then I said, is it Jehoshaphat or Jehoshaphat? And he says, they're two different guys. Can you imagine not just one person, but two people saddled with this kind of name, Jehoshaphat, Jehoshaphat? Different kings. This is a king of Judah. It's when there was Israel in the north and Judah in the south. Jehoshaphat is a different sort of king because he actually loves God and wants to follow God's will for his life. He's sort of distinct from many of the kings who just pick their own notes, if you will. So Jehoshaphat finds out Judah is kind of it's a pretty small nation, and it's surrounded by a whole group of tribal nation areas who are all vying for the same land, and there's a lot of battling going on. And a group, three different tribes, have banded together, Jehoshaphat finds out from his military intelligence, have banded together and said, the three of us can overthrow Judah together. Judah's got a decent army, but they're not real big. But if the three of us come together, we can overthrow Judah. So military intelligence tells Jehoshaphat, these guys are coming. And this, they ally themselves with one another, and they're coming up this way. And by the way, they have a way, way bigger military force than we do. And I want you to hear what Jehoshaphat does in response. Because, I don't know, I mean, I guess my first instinct would be, call all the generals, you know, and be like, all right, now we're going to figure this out, you know, like, they're bigger than us, but maybe we're smarter, and we're going to fight from here and fight from there, and we'd be talking about tactics and strategy. So Jehoshaphat, a vast army is coming from you from the other side of Edom, he says. And it says, alarmed when he heard this news, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the general, the Lord. And he proclaimed a fast for all the people. So not only did Jehoshaphat's first response entail his own going to God, but he asked everybody to. And people got together at the temple in Jerusalem, which is in Judah. And they were fasting and praying. And Jehoshaphat, as their military leader, stands up in front of them and prays this prayer to God and says, God, we know who you are. Like, you're the God who brought us out of Egypt. You're the God who promised us this land, who gave us, you know, military victory after victory so that we could live here. You're the God who loves us, who wants to use us to be a witness to the whole world. We know who you are. And we have heard this very specific news. And this is where it is so important, what he says. We have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us, he said. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. Basically, God, give us your starting note for this one. We need you to tell us where to start here. And in the context of that setting, this group of people praying, fasting, asking for God's help, the Holy Spirit fell on one of the men there, and he stood up, and he says, do not be afraid or be discouraged because of this vast army, for the battle is not yours, it is the Lord's. And I love that. I love that. Because this battle has always belonged to God. It seems like because the people of Judah are affected by this present situation, that they are the ones engaging in that battle. But Judah is the people of God. And if the people of God are under attack, the battle belongs to God. Is this not comforting in the battles that we have in our own lives, that we're like, oh no, I have this most recent challenge or difficulty or trouble, and I have to face it, and I have to figure out what's going on, and I need to, And the God who made you and loves you and knows about your life says to you, this battle is mine to fight in your life. I think that is awesome. Best military ally ever. So anyway, the guy who gets the Holy Spirit says, okay, the battle belongs to God. This is what the men are going to do. They're going to march out over there, and they're going to stand strong. And when they go, they're going to be singing a song. And the song, the word, give thanks to the Lord, his love endures forever. They're going to sing this song as they go, and then they're going to stand there. And they are not going to fight. God is going to fight the battle. That sounds ridiculous to me, by the way. My internal pitch on that would say, are you kidding me? You're just going to stand still and let the people attack you? Like, what are you not? But this is what the Holy Spirit said. And so early the very next day, the armies get out and they do what the man prophesied. They go and they sing this song and they stand firm. And the scripture tells us that when they began singing, those three allied tribes suddenly fell into discord and started to fight with each other before the people from Judah even arrived. And by the time that the people of Judah arrived to the location they were told to go and stood there and looked out into the place that was to be the battlefield, it was covered with dead bodies. All of their enemies had been destroyed because they fought with each other instead of with Judah. Now, what military strategist would have said, no, don't worry about fighting, just let them fight against each other? That's not a good human instinct, but it was the perfect note to start on. Jehoshaphat listened for that, and they prevailed. There's examples in Jesus' life later on. The biggest one that popped to my mind right away was Jesus' most passionate, sort of terrifying moment of his life, which was prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he was struggling between whether he needed to go to the cross or if he could get away from that death. I think once he was there on the cross, he knew he was in the middle of God's will and he was not as frightened. But in that wrestling in the garden, he was saying, give me the first note, God. Give me the first note. Tell me it's not that note. I can't do it if you put it right there. And God says, no, that's the note. And Jesus said, okay, then I'll sing. But even less sort of, even less sort of difficult, intense moments, just in the ministry of Jesus, he was able to be listening to what God was bringing in from the outside perspective instead of the people around him. Like when the woman was caught in adultery and everybody knew, the religious leaders knew, it was according to this very book right here, that women caught in adultery, they could be brought out in public and all the, you guys could pick up rocks and stone her to death in public. That was what people did with adulterous women. And they had her out there and they were ready to do it. And Jesus stood up and said, just a minute. The first person to cast a stone needs to be the person who has no sin here. And so nobody cast a stone. Jesus wasn't listening to the environment, to the internal pitches of the people around him. He was listening for God starting to open. Or when he healed somebody on the Sabbath, he restored them physically and spiritually, and the religious leaders were like, you shouldn't be doing that. We're not supposed to be worshiping on the Sabbath. That's right here in this book, too. And Jesus said, the point is health and wholeness of God's people. Who cares if it's Saturday? Because he was listening to God starting over from that. So this is what we endeavor to do as we think about who we are becoming as Christians, as people who listen for God, starting out. One final example, more modern. I'm reading this book, The Hiding Place, Corrie Ten Boom, autobiography. And she is a woman who lived outside Amsterdam in Holland during World War II, and was someone who ended up hiding Jewish people in her town. town in the little suburb that she lived in during World War II. She was a single woman. She was like 50 years old when the story, that story begins with her sister, who was also unmarried, and her father, who was widowed. They lived together above the father's watchmaking shop. Just regular business people living a regular life. They knew their neighbors. The business had been there for two generations almost, and they knew so many people in town. And then Germany conquered Holland, and in come the soldiers, and the rules start to change, and the curfews start to set, and people have to carry ID papers and wear the stars if they're Jewish. And these are their friends and their neighbors, and they see the climate changing. They're fearful for their friends, and their friends reach out to them and say, I can't go back home. They've targeted my house. Can I stay with you? And they say, sure, and our brother lives out in the countryside. Maybe we can get you out to the countryside where the occupying powers aren't as present, and it'll be safer for you out there. So we kind of figure out a route to get people from their town out to the countryside. And they realize that they need ration cards, and they need this, and they start to network and figure it out. And all of a sudden, she's like, here, this thing has developed around me. Like, this need has happened, and all of a sudden, we're standing in this place and realize that God has uniquely positioned us to be able to care for people in this way, even though it's absolutely frightening. She realizes some of the Jewish people who are in hiding are pregnant women. What if they have to deliver? Who's going to help deliver a baby for a woman in hiding? What if someone dies in hiding? What mortician is going to take them when they're not even supposed to exist in the first place? And she says, but we have all these relationships and we can do it because we're positioned well socially. And this is the thing that struck me about staying in tune with God. She realized she was going to have to reach out to other friends and neighbors who could help. And she said, we knew someone in every business and service in the city, but we didn't know, of course, the political views of these people. Some of the people were sympathetic, some people were anti-Semitic. But, and here I felt a strange leading of my heart, God did. My job was simply to follow his leading one step at a time, holding every decision up to him in prayer. I knew I was not clever, subtle, or sophisticated, but if our house was becoming a meeting place for need and supply, it was through some strategy far higher than mine. She was listening for God's starting. An internal pitch on that would have been to keep yourself safe, wouldn't it have been? Wouldn't you advise him? Oh my gosh, please, you got to take care of your family first. And yet she was listening for God's starting note and following that. Last point. So, I'm developing this sermon, and I'm thinking about pitches and things like this, and all of a sudden this illustration leaps in from the side. Does anybody do yoga here? Anybody practice yoga a little bit? So, I've had a number of different yoga teachers at the Y. I just drop in sometimes. And some of the teachers start out the class, and they're sitting still, and they say, we're going to chant an Om together. And it's very awkward, actually. Like, I was like, no, I don't want to do this at all. Like, and I feel like I sing okay. But what you're supposed to do is when the instructor leads you, you're supposed to say, Om. And everyone just starts on their own note, and it sounds like a train wreck. But the yoga instructor pointed out, among all the different definitions of Om, Om is the sound of the creation of the universe. That Om is this getting in touch with the vibrations of the creation around us. It's getting us in touch with the vibe of the universe, this pitch that the universe brings out to everybody. And I thought, oh man, you know, that's like an echo of what we're trying to say here. That's in Hinduism, but the idea that people would be seeking to hear that tone. For us, not of the creation, but of the Creator. The Creator. So that we can be in line with what the Creator is doing here on earth. So I pray that we would be becoming people who would be in tune with God, listening for God's pitch to start us on. I'm going to wrap it up here because I didn't know this sermon was this long. I enjoyed it. But think to yourself, how do you know that that pitch is right? You might say, like, I have a piano to give me the key of G, so I know that that note is right. But how do you say, I think my starting note here on this one is coming from God? I don't think it's internal. You relate it to a Bible story, you talk to your friends, you pray for your friends, you fill in the rest, right? But that's the next point. How do you get that pitch? We have some people who always like to get their tuning from God, named Elaine and Cindy Tanner, who are joining the church this morning. So why don't you all come on up?
Whole family, right?
Whole family.
She's a little hard to keep track of.
We get Gigi to come in here. We would like to hear from either of you, or any of you, where you come from, how you found us. 2 minutes, not long. Start on any note you like.
2 minutes each?
No.
So, we didn't figure out who goes first. When you were talking about the Star Spangled Banner, and Gigi didn't hear this part, but you wrote the story. Every time we have to sing happy birthday in our house, if someone gets to start, and it's always the wrong note. It's too high, it's too low. So you start, I don't ever get to start anymore because mine's always awful. As proclaimed by them, mine's. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. With or without this?
No, you say good. Okay, thank you. Good. So we start, and then we all stop, and we all laugh. And what we get to at the end is that we all just basically scream.
Because you just can't, we can't even say no. We're all in pain. So kind of a little bit, I know we've been spending time here. We turned around and said, yeah, we didn't decide to become members until we made sure we liked you guys. And we like you a little bit now. We're in the fold. And so we're starting a new year and we're kind of stepping into it. But we've all gotten to know some of you, but you haven't seen us all kind of here together, and you can see we're all pretty unique in our own way, but kind of the story goes, and we'd love to spend more time with you one-on-one, getting to know each of you. We've done a lot of that, but we need to do more, is that Elaine and I started out in the Mid-Atlantic area, in the Baltimore area, and then we went all the way out to the West Coast in San Diego, where we lived for a long time, and we started a family. So for us, our hometown, if you will, is kind of the Baltimore area. And for these guys, it's San Diego is kind of their hometown. So we lived there for a while, and then we moved back to Maryland for a few years. And then we've been up here a little over two years now. And what we're finding about this area is that we love it. And I think that when these guys talk about their hometown when they're our age, our young age, they will refer to it as the Boston area, and all of you. So that's where we came from, it's who we are. You don't have to know how old we are. They're all kind of the same age, 14, 15-ish, and Gigi is 10, well, there she is, 10 and a half, right down there.
Aww.
And she thinks it's funny, so great. So here we are.
And you guys are church folk, and you came from a Methodist church in Maryland, is that right?
We've belonged to a lot of different churches, but we're transferring our membership today from a Methodist church in the Maryland area. So we're Methodesians, or...
Wesleyans.
Did you see it? I knew it was Wesleyan. I got her. She went. So that's what we're doing. So we're part of the Methodist church. We have been for a little while, and we're transferring our membership today.
Awesome. And Elaine is a pastor's kid. You're a pastor.
My dad was a Lutheran pastor.
Lutheran pastor.
She does speak, but she's hacking up a lung, so.
we in San Diego, we belong to a United Church of Christ. So basically, we belong to the United Church of Christ and to Methodist churches.
Well, we're glad to have you, and Alex, and Adam, and Ashton. It starts with an A, if you're wondering what the name is.
All A's, two syllables.
And Gigi. Okay, so what we're doing today is Alex and Ashton and Adam are all in confirmation. They will become members when they're confirmed, when you're considered an adult in the eyes of the church. And Gigi, that'll happen for you in a few years too. So the membership is just for mom and mom today. All right? Very good. So, brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are incorporated into God's holy church. We're incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth by water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. These baptized individuals come to us for membership this morning. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin?
I do.
Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves?
We do.
Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races?
We do.
All right. And do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ?
We do.
You all can see your words right there on the screen. Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include these people now before you in your care? With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround them with a community of love and forgiveness that they may grow in their trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life. And here's where we remind ourselves of the confession of faith made by Christians of all types and stripes and denominations and sizes, and Catholics too, in the Creed. Let us join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
And because Elaine and Cynthia are already baptized and made that confession of faith, they belong to the Church Universal. They've already been members of the General United Methodist Church, and so now it is for us to bring them into this local congregation. So Elaine and Cindy, as members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service?
We will.
Members of the household of God, I commend these people to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. The God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. Elaine and Cindy, welcome.
Thank you.
All right, so as their first act of service, which is so not, because you know that they have
birthday.
You know that they won the Christmas pageant. Some of them will be serving us communion this morning. So those of you who are serving, pop up there. And those of you who are coughing, go sit down there. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body and the blood of Christ, redeemed by his love. By your Spirit, make us one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Jesus comes in final victory and we feast in his heavenly banquet. Amen.
Amen.
The table is prepared. Please come.
Thank you.
It's now time for our offering. Let us pray. Lord God, you pour out so many gifts on us all the time. Just ask that we would be mindful of them, that we name them to ourselves and to others, that you do love us so much. Thank you for the gift of this morning. Thank you for the gift of new members and for the gift of music. God, we ask that you would receive this offering that we give to you as an expression of our thanks and gratitude. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Experience the Aldersgate community. So breakfast this coming Saturday.
And then Sunday, a week from today, after church, we are going to be, anyone who has a passion for this is welcome to join in a meeting for New Year's planning for Aldersgate for 2017. It is a lunch meeting, lunch with the catered for kiddies, and we're just going to sit down for a few hours and talk about what was great about 2016 and what we would like to see happen in 2017. So again, that's for anybody who has a passion in helping to set some goals for this coming year, next Sunday afternoon. There is a sign-up sheet for that, right, Paul Schaefer has it right there near the coffee hour table. We need to know so we know how much food to get. So if you're planning on coming, sign up on that sheet, or you can respond to the church email link as well. The address for, talk to Joni, where's Joni McNally? Right there in the beautiful red, it's 9 Berridge Road in North Reading. It's off of North Street in North Reading.
The first right of North, from Main to North First Right.
Okay, the first right-hand turn after China Cuisine on North Street.
Exactly.
So her house smells good all the time. Awesome. Okay.
Rachel?
Yes.
Real quick too. For all those that see the June 15th Missions Teams meeting, although there is a missions team, right? The church is the missions team. So anybody with ideas for upcoming missions opportunities for the coming years, speak to Sam, myself, or John Wise, and we'll try to get them in.
Yeah, Laurie Downs as well.
Oh, yeah. I completely forgot. She's our new chairman to the food pantry.
That's right. So next Sunday after church.
Next Sunday after church.
So you guys are doing your missions meeting and then coming over to the planning meeting right after.
Yes.
Awesome. We will save you food. Yeah.
It's from kiddies. Don't worry.
Awesome. So that's what's going on as best as I know it. Celebration and thanks. We have a thanks to Kevin and Bobby for doing snow cleanup for the parking lot outside for today. So let's give them a hand. Joey on the keyboard and Wesley subbing on drums and Eli subbing on PowerPoint, all the subs that had to happen so that we could go forward this morning. And we look forward to Daniel and Michael being back with us next week as well. Yes, Cindy.
Just a thank you to us up there, to the Lane and me, but I got to tell you, there's a whole lot of everybody involved in the pageant. And the only way we agreed to do it is that everybody helped us. So there's a lot more names that belong up there. And it made it easy for us to just